seeing such a big turnout tonight. Apologies about the sort of crowdedness. We are, I guess, very lucky that so many people are excited about this event. As you can see, you know, our space is a little bit small, but we're hoping that we'll have a nice, cozy discussion about early childhood development. So I'm Kai Scholz, I'm the director of the Impact Center, and me and a team of excellent young people who are enthusiastic about education organize these seminars once every 2 weeks, 3 months. So some of the speakers that we've had in the past include last month was Mary Metcalf talking about the Pilo project. Before that we had Crane Sedin talking about decolonization. So we have a range of different topics, but every month we'll have a new talk. So if you aren't already, find us on Facebook at Education Fish Tank or on Twitter at Edufish Tank, and we'll circulate some sign-up sheets if you prefer email. Okay, so anybody who would like to go to the bathroom, if you enter and you walk a little bit further down the passageway, there are two bathrooms on your right-hand side. So if anybody needs to go to the bathroom, you're welcome to do that. In terms of the Twitter hashtag, our Twitter hashtag for this event is hashtag PolicyECD. We've already started tweeting on that, towns and there's some questions, and Eric Atmore is busy calling out the statistics that Ilifela Banchwana have used in terms of a number of quality ECD centers, the number of registered number of children attending ECD centers in the country. So if you're interested in just seeing how that discussion unfolds, you can also go find us there. So the Education Fish Tank has two purposes. On the one hand, what we want to do is we want to promote information, quality information about the education sector. So we are a public education initiative. But on the other hand, we also want to do community building. So the way that we organize these events, we have amazing speakers come and talk. We then organize a question and answer session afterwards. And then afterwards, anybody who would like to is welcome to join us as we go for dinner after the event. So anybody is welcome to join us for dinner. That will sort of happen around 8 o'clock. And then finally, I wanted to just introduce our speakers for the evening. So Linda Bierstecker probably doesn't need any introduction, but I'm going to introduce her anyway. She is one of my favorite speakers, so I'm really excited to have you come join us. I've seen her twice
before.
No pressure from me. I think she's been had a long history of being director at the Early Learning Resources Unit. Toby is joining us from Elderly tonight. She's also been involved in a number of significant projects, the ECD, Western Cape ECD audit back in 2009, is that? Mm-hmm. Most recently involved in the early learning outcomes measure, the ELARM assessment tool that's been developed to measure quality in early childhood development across the country these days. So really a real depth of experience, and we're very lucky to have her joining us tonight. We also have Linda Masilenga, who will be talking sort of more from on the ground perspective. You know, it's one of the things that we try to pride ourselves on at Fish Tank is it is very important to engage from the research and the policy perspective, but it is also important to understand that, you know, these things happen in a place with particular people. So we're very lucky to have Linda joining us today. She's a businesswoman, runs an early childhood development center as well as a clothing business, incredibly is doing the hard work of bringing up young children in South Africa today. And David will be facilitating the conversation. And David, I'm lucky, you know, is a colleague and a friend of mine who has a number of different hats. So he's the founder of something called Early Reach, which is an innovative project helping to do dialogic, helping to understand the reading habits of parents. He's also the director of
operations
at the Mukulu Trust, which is an evidence-based, basically one of the programs run by the World Health Organization's Parenting for Lifelong Health. And Parenting for Lifelong Health prides itself on doing evidence-based programming. So David has a lot of experience in the sector as well. Great, so that's everything from me. I'm going to hand over to Linda and then David.
Good evening, everybody.
I should have said which Linda. Linda,
I'll stop then. Okay. I'm not going to take forever.
I think when Tan said, would I like to talk, the thing that really has become very topical in policy is this whole issue of what does it actually take to shift early learning outcomes. Now, there is absolutely no doubt in my mind at all that ECD is good for a whole lot of things. It's good for children, it's good for women particularly. It provides a whole lot of opportunities for safe and quality care that make, which is a protective thing, which is where ECD started off originally. But what has happened in how we kind of talk about it over the last few years is we've held out this promise. Okay, so you've all seen this slide, this brain slide, I'm sure, before. This is the stimulated brain, this is the unstimulated brain. Starts in pregnancy, it's all pretty much over by 1,000 days. Then the other big driver is the Heckman economic returns, okay? And based on this evidence, countries all over, particularly low and middle income countries, are pushing to introduce rapidly scaled up early childhood services to get these returns. And so the question is this the very best way to go? It was that evidence that we, because we believe in ECD, that we advocated and the sector advocated and got Sustainable Development Goal 4.2, which is very educationally framed, right? That by 2030 we're going to ensure that all children have access to quality early childhood development care and pre-primary education, so they're ready for primary school. So the driver for all of this is school readiness, human capital development, and returns. It's not about the other sort of social impacts, obviously. And so I'm really going to focus today then on if we want this for school readiness purposes, if we want to be using this, what needs to be done. So let's have a little just look at the gap. Now, first of all, when children come into any early learning program, they're bringing a whole lot of stuff with them. This is just based on the very famous Lancet Walker paper. So where we've got contributing to the child's brain development and function is all sorts of child rearing issues, home issues, care situations, poverty, food insecurity, as well as biological risk factors, including probably one of the biggest challenges here being stunting at 20%. Okay. Right, so in other words, your program, your ECD program, is going to deal with a child that's come with one sort of collection or other of those kinds of experiences. And one of the things we don't know yet, and we're hoping to find out more about, is what is it reasonable to expect if a child has very adverse early things? How far can our early learning program actually make up the gap? We don't really know yet. We know certain things. I'm going to talk about those today. We do know from the studies that very disadvantaged children benefit more from ECD programs. But they don't just mean a learning program. They would talk about health and nutrition and affectionate care, as well as learning and stimulation. So that is just something I want to leave with you, because I sometimes think that we are setting ourselves up to be terribly disappointed at what we can achieve, when actually it's just that our piece as education is only one piece of this whole package of services, which the policy, in fact just about every policy in any country, any new early childhood policy will talk to all of the factors, but which are very difficult to deliver, especially in resource-constrained contexts. Now, I do believe that in South Africa, we probably are in a much better position to start tackling these things, say, than in some of the countries in the region, and we should be. So that's why this talk tonight is a great opportunity. Now, I'd like to just show, if Nick Spall was here, he'd be showing you the annas, right? He'd be showing the differentials. The early learning outcome measure that we've been working on, and Liz is in the back to chip in. Where are you there? Is a measure of how children would perform in pre-grade R, at the end of pre-grade R, based on what would be useful for them in grade R. And I just want to show you, in our age validation, the website of this, if anyone's interested, is going live tomorrow. Liz, hope so. And we can pop it up and you can check and have a look. It's a measure that can be used to find out about your programs, and some of you here are doing that. But what we did in the age validation is we just had a look at how children in different quintiles were doing. And I've just chosen two of the domains. Quintiles 2 and 3 clumped together, and 4 and 5 quintiles is your income groups. Quintile 1 is your poorest children. Quintile 4 and 5 are the top sort of 40%. And what you'll see here then on a measure of cognition and executive functioning, which is one of the things that predicts very, very much for school performance, is that this is the younger age group, at 50 to 59 months, there's quite a huge difference between the quintiles. Very similar to what you'd see on the annals, in fact. Okay? And for the older group, in some cases, it seems to even be widening. So that's just for cognition. I'll show one other. There are 5 domains. Gross motor development is not one where there's a big difference, but on all the ones that kind of count for academic performance, it's big. This is language and literacy. I think a lot of you are involved in that kind of work. And again, you'll see an enormous difference. And this is a test that we have done all the psychometrics on. It is as culture fair as a test can be. It's not that there are language issues or culture issues that are affecting it. It's simply a matter of poverty and life experiences. And again, you'll see that then those children in quintiles 4 and 5 are starting school with an enormous advantage in terms of language and literacy. So these are the kinds of things that our programs, our early learning programs, are needing to work on. And so this is our kind of a graph of the total. And what we've divided them up to, having had quite a number of discussions with government stakeholders and others, into 3 bands. So the green is what one would expect children to reach. That's your standard. This is the ones who are at risk. And the middle band is the ones who are falling behind. And so you'll see that quintile 1, the middle point of quintile 1, is sitting here. So some of the quintile 1 children, if that's a middle point, will be in the green, but much less of them. The group here, what's happened to the wrong button? Here we are, so this is your 4 and 5. Some of them will be in the red, but more of them will be in the green, and that's what we're looking at. So just to think about then, what do our programs have to be like to work? So that's just the context. So what works? And just the quality literature is huge. I'll just going to quickly whip through some of the key things that have been generally or still thought to be associated from many, many studies associated with good learning outcomes. So now we're not focusing on the other outcomes, we're simply focusing on the learning. So the first one is that there needs to be a lot of free choice activities with carefully selected materials. No big surprises, that's all what we teach, what we encourage. That there needs to be opportunities to interact with your peers, but also with your teachers in 2 kinds of groups, like when the teacher facilitates a small group or an individual child's learning, right? Or when the teacher leads a group. And there's some interesting things to talk about adult-led activities, it's your group times later on, which I personally found quite shocking from my point of view and my particular pedagogical preferences, but we'll get there in a minute. Okay, then, interestingly, somebody asked a question already about culture. There are cultural variations in what teacher-child ratios and class sizes might be acceptable. It's not very cut and dried. I mean, we kind of had the idea that it should be a small class is better, etc. But they find in certain situations, such as in Japan, classes of 30 can lead to exactly the same kind of outcome because of how people are used to working and how they handle things. Teacher training, we put a fortune into qualifications training. And on some studies, qualifications count. And certainly we do want people to know what they're doing. But qualifications, as we all know, because the NGO sector where I work on that will go around saying they don't know how to do, they're not implementing, the qualifications alone don't make a difference. And what is coming up more and more in all studies is teachers need hand-on support. How do you do this? Coaching, mentoring. And they need that through in-service training and on-site support by experts and from their supervisors who are taking instructional leadership. And then the big deal, they need motivation and decent working conditions. It's very difficult to stay motivated under very difficult working conditions. And a lot of the study, and this, interestingly enough, it's not just from poor countries that this data is coming. I mean, if you would look at an analysis of early childhood issues in Europe or anywhere else, you'll all these same kind of issues come up. I think it's a question of degree, but they're not that different. And then a big deal is you need oversight and support from your relevant departments, but then they need to know what they're doing and how to support, and facility managers. Then this, what happened in the States when they started finding out that pre-kindergarten wasn't working as well as they'd hoped, it was fading out. They had a lot of soul searching. There have been some interesting monographs coming out about that. And one of the things that's come up is that if your aim is to promote school readiness, then to have a curriculum that is actually focused on particular activities, which is very grade R, isn't it? Have a math slot or a literacy slot, which is actually more successful than a more general whole child curriculum, which will talk about maths, talk about language, but not have a very, very clear purpose. So I personally love the idea of whole child approaches, and I was really disheartened, but the evidence is pretty clear. That doesn't mean that you shouldn't have small and large group instruction and free choices and so forth. That's important. And the other thing that you really, I think one mustn't lose focus on, and I know there are other people in this room who feel strongly about it, is non-cognitive approach to learning capacities. Because they seem to be the thing that is associated with longer term success. So you might have an academic advantage if you have a good structured pre-maths and literacy program, but what will probably last is if you know how to, if you're keen to learn, if you know how to apply yourself, if you can control your behavior, etc. And those are the things that there seems to be a rather less of in, certainly in most radar classes, because everyone is so anxious about basically the sort of academic curriculum. Then the next thing, just a new monograph you might like to take a look at, and I can certainly pass on the reference. And that is just having a look at what actually made the difference. Because in the sort of disappointing US data, there were certain schools and kids that did better. And they started to look at what that was about. And the first rule, and this would be as much for parenting programs or anything else, is for cognitive outcomes, longer is stronger. 2 years is better than 1 year. Our SACMEC data says much the same thing. 3 years is a bit better than 2 years, but two seem to be quite a kind of key thing. 2 years of Head Start rather than one would give better academic skills on exit and the end of grade R than one, but larger gains in academic skills are achieved when teachers spend more time on related content areas. So not a general program, but more with specific slots. The other thing they're finding, and this is very crucial, and it's our big challenge, and I'd love to hear what Linda has to say about how you deal with the quality issue, is that children do better if there is a level of quality, moderate to high level of general quality in their classroom. And that's on measures such as the one we used in the 2009 audit, etc. If you don't have a general level of quality, you're actually not going to realize any of the gains. And they're trying to work out, they haven't worked out what the exact thresholds are and the exact dosages are, but there's quite a lot of evidence of that. So we need to be thinking about how do we up the general quality as well as the specific inputs to get those. So that was just something to get you talking and thinking. This slide here is based on that a big evaluation study we did of a range of different kinds of programs, and I put it in because some people did ask about parent programs, so about Bisana. And what we found for school readiness is that the greatest, so all of these things are really important for children and for their well-being and for their general development, and which would underpin how they did for school. But the greatest probability of improving school readiness was quality early childhood centres. If you had a playgroup, it should have a high dose input that was focused on school readiness content, and then teacher training and school training and support would underpin that. So those are the sorts of things, and I know a lot of you are working in those kinds of areas. So I thought, just before Linda talks about how she's dealing with things, I'll just dig up a bit of it's old, but I don't think it's out of date. And unfortunately, I think it's still going on. Some of the things that we're up against, and this is local data. So in our 2009 audit, which was commissioned by the Social Development Department of Quality, first thing is that children in the poorest areas, on the whole, get the worst quality services. This doesn't mean there aren't good centres in those areas, but on the whole, poor children get poor things. Because why? Because fees are the biggest associated thing with quality. Classes for babies and toddlers are generally awful. They're much worse than for older children. You almost see as you get towards grade R, it improves. Also interesting, if there's a grade R class in a community school, then the 3 to 4 class tends to be a bit better, sort of comes down. Just to say, this isn't just a unique South African thing at all around the world, classes for babies and toddlers are worse than for older children. It's like nobody's really gives them their due in terms of, even though we now know about the 1,000 deaths. The other thing that, apart from fees, which really was highly associated in our regression analysis with quality, is management and administration. So if you've got a good manager, and it's not even pedagogical management, it's just someone who can, you know, get everything sorted out, then you will have a better school. So in poor schools where the fees were low, that was the defining factor. So it's an area generally in quality that hasn't been looked at in a great deal of detail. It's starting to come up all over as well as it has been going to look at. Then, having said this, let's just have a look. This is a bit unfair because it was another DSD study of unregistered facilities. But let's just have a look then. If we said that materials are important, just have a look at a few areas of the Western Cape. So this is the Western Cape line, blue one. This is the Wynberg district. In terms of paper, crayons, paint, scissors, glue, etc. Another one in terms of equipment. There's Wynberg for blocks, make-believe play, books, toys, puzzles, and building. and here we have Khayelitsha and Athlone somewhere in the middle. So essentially we are seeing, you know, that poor areas don't have the right equipment. I haven't got a breakdown of teacher qualifications, but you probably see a trend there too. And then the last one I just wanted to show you is food. I think this is really important. In the non-metro areas, parents were providing a lot of the food. So in the sort of more rurally areas, etc., where children are very sort of struggling, there's a lot of reliance on parents to provide feeding for kids at school. And that's also something, you know, that you really do feel that one of the things that we don't look at in terms of learning outcomes, but is clearly important, is the quality of feeding that children get, especially if they're in full daycare. If they're in a playgroup and they get food twice a week when they need, it probably helps them to concentrate, and that's not a bad thing. But I remember when I worked long ago at the Athlone Early Learning Centre, we used to give the kids two snacks or two meals. And in the holidays, their weight used to drop off. And I don't think that's different now. It's probably worse in a lot of situations. So it's not something we focused on, but I think it's a crucial element of any program. And just before Linda comes, I just thought I'd show you a few pictures that cheered me up when I saw them. Because you often go quite a long way to find a nice school. You visit a school and you think, well, you know, where would you take someone if they wanted to see something really excellent? So I was absolutely thrilled to see them doing box construction at the centre. I haven't seen that for years. Or to see a concrete kind of nice grid art thing. Or to see a whole lot of little boys playing make-believe, or children feeling able to actually whisper in their teacher's ear. And you know, that's the other thing, because all of this quality, the focus on it is actually around how you scaffold learning. And I think Lily and others could certainly talk about how you do that. It's not just about being there, it's about how you speak to children and what you say to them. And I just want again to say one of the most cheery things that I've seen in a long time is in a grade R circle time. It was a very experienced teacher, and they were doing some shapes. I don't think they should have been doing shapes. It was too early in the year. I know that the captain's a bit tough about that. But she wasn't holding up the thing and saying, this is a circle, what is it? Which I've seen a lot of, I'm sure you all have. She had a child come and sit, and she had a poster, and she could you describe this, so they couldn't see it, could you describe this shape to the children in the class? And he looked very puzzled for a bit. It was quite early in the year, and he said, well, it doesn't have any corners, and it doesn't have any sides. And somebody said that it must be a circle, and I thought, that's such a different way of teaching than saying this is a circle, can you find another circle in the room? It's like really getting them to engage and extract the property. Mm. So I do think we have some great teachers, and I think so now we're going to hear from them. Thank you.
I just saw the kids lying around.
And then there is like an end road in front of me. So I just told myself, even if, although I don't have a yard, but I can make a safe place for this children. So I just like, it was just a joke because I just take everything like a joke. So I just go each and every, I just go knock each and every door for my neighbors. And then I told them my vision that I want to open an education center. So I just registered them, each and everyone that who is interested to start.
Mm-hmm.
So they were interested that year. And then I started with the number of 22. So I did start this, and then it was the kitchen, and then the bedroom, it was the double storehouse. So when I see this number, 22, and then I did go to my neighbor at the back also, and then I asked her, she was having a trunk at the back, and then she was not using it. I said, if you can give me this trunk, and then I can extend, so that I can provide this, like, this children a nice place for them. And then she gave it to me, and then I started opening it. And then, from that year, I did told you that I didn't even go to the training. It was my sister who did go to Proteaville and everything. But I didn't discuss anything about the education center because she did the program and stuff in Protea. And then there was another lady that I met. She was working in Kailicha, Kurula Education Center. And then I go to her. And then I told her that I did open a center. And then I didn't know the rhymes, I didn't know anything. And then she said, now I can assist you. On that time, it was the fantasy, those made belief corners and stuff, it was made belief that time. Now we said, that's a fantasy, educational corner. I don't know anything about those corners. I just go and visit and then each and every week she took me to her center and then I go. And then I thought, hey, this is very nice. And then I'm not creative at the same time, really. But I've got ideas on my head, but I'm not creative. But I go there and then I saw the tree there and then she made this tree and then this tree is inside the house. And then I saw the eggs, she put the scissors and stuff at the back. Hey, it was so beautiful. And then I just keep on going. And then she write the runs for me. Everything she write. And then I just look at her when she's doing the action and stuff. And then I said, no, this is going to be my mentor. It's a lot of stuff that I'm going to learn from this lady. So as from then, and then she gave me an advice that if you can go to the college or if you can go to grassroots, and then I go to grassroots, and then I had the training, I do the level one. And then after I do the level one, still, you know, most of just read and then there's no practical on level one, really. There's no practical if you're on level four. You just read the stuff all. And then, that thing was growing, and then I end up, I don't know, from 208, 204, I end up having 110 grand. And then I was like, extending now. This house you see is the brick thing there. I did extend it with the shark at the back. And then also this yard in front, there was a shark for the babies. And then that kitchen, it was at the back. I just extended it. I put another on that at the back. I put another, and I made a kitchen there. And then there was a class for break up. And then in the front there was babies. And then in the kitchen downstairs, there was like two friends. So I did end up with having three classes. And then I was having five staff. On that time, it was even terrible because my teachers did get 600, 800.
Mm-hmm.
Because they, at that time they were paying 80 rands, 150. You just manage the food for your children and then maybe the hair and then they can like provide themselves. But they were not complaining because they see that we are struggling to care. And then I don't know what happened. From 208 I told myself, oh, the social service still came visit. She didn't tell me that she wants to register myself. And then she said, you must like take this and then you must put a ceiling and stuff. I did have the money to put ceiling, but she didn't tell me that I'm going to put you on a registration. And then I said, no man, I don't want this shack and stuff. I need to build this again. And then they just marched out. He didn't tell me anything. And then I just like, as you see me, I'm not registered. And then he just marched out with the money and stuff. And then, but I managed.
I do this and Canelo thing, Canelo thing, Canelo thing, Canelo thing. And then God provide me, because I just made this for 2 months. Because if you want something, you told me something that you wanted, because I've got the passion. There is upside downs and everything, but I told myself I need this because I'm already on it.
Mm.
Hey, when I finish this, I just sit with the parents first. I said, guys, since I'm building now, I've got 120, just bear in mind. I just call up the meeting. I told them, since I'm going to build this house and stuff like that, so I'm not going to provide the food, the meals for the children, because I must finish this. And then they said, yeah, no problem and stuff. After I finish it, shame they manage, I finish it. But after I finish it, one by one, I end up with 20. Hey, I just look at myself and then I told myself, no, I want to close this. Mm-hmm. And then I was having those teachers, and then I just called the meeting again. I said, guys, you see the situation. At the end of the month, there's nothing I'm going to give you. So it's better if I can work with one person, because I only have 20. And then at that time, that person I was giving her a 1.2. So they understand. And then I did work with her, and then I started this business, buying the clothes from Tropic and selling. So it was not stressful. And then I go to my mother. My mother did provide a lot, because when I didn't have croissant and stuff, she just came and provided me. I didn't get any sponsor from anyone. And then there were parents also. Hey, it's not easy, really. It's not easy. There were parents, they just, you don't even see them. They just open the gate. Leave the child on the gate, you will see the child. And then you ask them, you call the meeting, and then you sit with them, and then say, I'm not going to take the child, I'm not going to do this and this. And then there are times, really, you have to send the child back, because they take, sometimes they've got the money, but they take advantage of you. So if you send the back, and then the parent will be like, no, you must come when you have money. And then as the time passes, you just think about that child, because it's not the mother. The mother, she just leave the child there, and then you ask yourself, by the time I open this center, I want to assist that child. So now you are not doing it. You just send that child back home. And then our parents, they didn't even go to the centers that time. So they don't know the need. They see the need, because they expect their child from at the age of 5 years, they must write it, because they came from the center. They said, I expect my child to write the name at the age of 4 years.
Mm.
If you tell this child is not ready to write the name and stuff, so they expect that. They are going to change the schools at the same time, because you are not taking their child, they are not writing, they are not doing anything. Only the child are doing this, they are complaining. And then they take their child. So I just sit up with them, and then I manage. Because some of them, they were paying, some of them, they are not paying. Until from 2005. And then I was having 40, 20, 30 something. Especially on truth, they ran away. There's no fees, there's nothing, because the schools are closed. So you are struggling on that year. On December, I get it, only 10 at December. And then, so that's the upside down. So, in 2004, 2005, there was an organization, they came, African Impact. They did assist a lot. Because when they came, they said they are going to work with me, they will assist me on the registration thing, stuff. I said, yes. I was happy. And then, what makes me happy? They are up there, they told me that they are going to bring the volunteers each and every day. They are going to be there at the center. They bring their toys, and then they go with the toys. I didn't have like too much resources that time. So even especially for outdoor playing, I didn't have. So they come and provide, and then it was very nice, because like I saw the change when when my children go to the interview, and then they came. They pass the interview. They know, even if you came inside and then you can ask them in English, they speak English fluently. So I was happy working with them. So they asked, they helped me a lot, because when our people see that there is a white people in my center, oh, they can't get registered. The Kesana get full again. And then even if like I get I don't have transport. It's the people that are around the community is the one they bring their own child. If you want transport, you provide your own transport. I don't have transport.
Mm.
So I get the people, I get the parents from Filifi, from Nyanga, because when they go through, it's the main road, as I told you earlier, it's the main road. When they go up and down, they saw the railway out, doubling, they saw the white people, and then they told me, I want an education. So African Impact did help me, because it did help me with the yard and stuff and stuff. Also, there is an early childhood development center. They did provide us with the training of governing body, because now you've got parents sometimes. The parents, they just get involved. But when they get involved in your center, they are going to be their managers. Because you are going to tell them that you need to take this amount to take to the bank. They want to know that amount that you are taking them to the bank and stuff like that. So they take them to the trainings and then they tell them that your duty is this, your secretary, your everything. And then they tell them their portfolios. And then they also provide us with their resources. They give us, they are the ones also help me with the desk, everything. And then they give me the kids to start. And then from there, now I can see that where I'm going. And then I know now I'm running this education, and then I know what is an education. So I also take my teachers to the trainings. And then I mentor them, because like I just give them the trainings. And then also the other centers, if they need trainings around me, I just gave them the trainings. Because like, since I'm like 17 years on the field now, I was like young now, but I'm not young anymore because of my experience and that and stuff. And then from then, I did get to see early childhood, and then she did assist us with training and stuff. And then also grassroots did also help us, because grassroots did provide us with the trainings as well, and then also with sight learning programs. Sight learning programs is all less with CAPS, which is I didn't do the CAPS, they kept what they said they wanted to be great art teacher, the one who's got great art and then got stuff in. And then I met SAEP. Yeah? After I met SAEP, he also introduced us to Unlimited Child, and then she take all the teachers. Also, I don't want, hey guys, really, you did mention something about We've got infants, right?
Yes.
I was running this center almost 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. But when I go to the class of babies, from 6 months to 12 months to 18 months, I don't know what must I do on that class.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie.
Yeah.
Because I don't have experience.
Mm.
I don't have training. I can just like play. I play with the children. I do everything. But I told myself, and then I find myself guilty, because like I told myself, when I asked myself like I told myself that I'm supposed to teach them. There's something that I must like do to those children. But when I figure out, and then when I ask somebody to help me, I don't know what must I do. So there is this training that came Unlimited Child. He took the practitioner from 0 to 3. And then we also go to that land, that training. And then as from then, we are masters. I did encourage now, even if I don't want to lie. Even to the parents, they told me that I don't have a man. I don't even on June. I just told them, don't take your children because you told yourself it's June. That child, most the child forgets. So if you take her on leave or you take her on holiday, when she came back, she forgets everything. So at least just take that child inside. My children, I'm not saying it because I'm in front of you guys.
Okay.
Even, I'm proud of my school. It's not like the way I want it to be, but I know on the other day I'm going somewhere.
Yes.
But in implementing my practitioners, My nomos, when you are not around, they can do whatever they want. But they know when I get in the yard, they know I must do the right thing. Even like on Monday we go to school and then the other hour that my colleague did also go and visit and said, you are elected teachers, man. Even if you are not around, they are doing, they are on a right track. They are like, they, all the children are busy. So I like, on like, what I'm going to say, ne, to the person who want to open the education, there is upside down. You must have a passion, ne, if you want it. And then you mustn't tell yourself you want money. Because if you want money, you are not going to do it. If you want money, you are not going to do it. It's a loan. My experience, I've got 17 years. I told myself on this year, I don't get any sponsor from anyone. Only this in salary will be there. You know salary will be there. The good salary is there. Only SAP did came share. At least she tried her best. We've got, we are 8 educators in our area. Ne? She tried to provide. There is containers, they also provide, because like at the end of the month you must buy a premium. By at the 25th, the food is finished. And then you know those ones, sometimes you tell yourself, I don't want to take this one, because they can say at home that we didn't eat anything. But transparency is good. Transparency is very good. Because, like now, what I say to the parents, guys, if you pay this amount at the end of the month, and then don't expect me, I'm going to buy groceries for your own children. I'm not going to do that. I've got staff who's looking after your children. I'm going to pay my staff first, and then I'll see what left, and then I can buy groceries. On June, if there is like, I've got 20, like on June, from 86, I was having 20, 30 something. Where I'm going to get the money to buy groceries, I'm not going to get the money for groceries. Sometimes I was having 5 practitioners, and then I asked 3 of them. They must stop the kids because it's true. It's terrible. It's very hard. But if you explain to them, it's just enter the site and then it goes to the site. Maybe you are talking with them. When there is a wind is blowing outside, and then they just take everything for granted. So there are those challenges. But I said, if you've got passion, you can do it. If you've got passion, you can do it. Just be strong enough. Like this year, I told myself I'm going to be get registered and stuff. But I told myself I've got fire extinguisher, fire blanket, everything. And then my school, each and every time Jeremy came, I think that you need everything. And then I changed the toilets and it. And then there are times Jeremy marched in and then he said, you know, you need to change that toilet. I said, Jeremy, I'm not going to change that toilet. Because you only told me that I must change the toilet, and then there's no money you give me to change that toilet. You are not helping me at all. And then she just, I don't know whether she just called Fezeka and stuff, because I just saw the people of Fezeka last year, December, came and changed the toilet. Because each and every time the toilet was leaking. And then I told myself, I'm not going to do anything. And then I told him that, I'm not going to do anything, Jeremy. I don't want to lie to you. I'm saying to your face, I'm not going to do it. And then he said, did you go to building? I said, I go to building. Here is the letter of building. I did go. You must call the inspector. I just called it. I should SAP did call the inspector. And then when he called the inspector, he was complaining fire, and then must do this and this. And then also SAP did help us with administration. Yay, we are lazy to do administration. She just like sit with us, all those books. Yeah, I just told them, guys, I don't mind if you are going to like run after me each and every month and then see that I did. I know if you are like after me, I'm going to do it. I don't have a problem. But I know, I must know that there is someone to go to. And then they do that. The policies, the contracts, man, we are like, now we've got contracts. Really, you feel that you are really a manager when you go there. Because somebody when is marching there, and then you said, can I have your CV? Here are your contracts. this is, you must sign the contract, you must do this and this and this. And then, you know, even if like you are not happy with it, you must finish for a contract to finish. And then it's like, no man, I'm not going to renew your contract because you are not happy with you are working with it. And then she can't even take you to the CNA because there is this thing that is binding you. And then, so now, like, what I want to say is that now we are like, we've got everything and then we know everything done on the other things. Like I said to the parents, to encourage them, I asked them, even if I saw the child that is not going to school, I said, don't even take to my education. But what about that children's future? Because there is a difference. You can even, the child that started education at 5 years old, 5 years old, and then there is these ones, you start from the beginning with them. When you start with this one, you struggle a lot. You struggle, there is a slow learner, you know that there is a slow learner, but you struggle a lot, and then there is an inclusive that they also come, and then they teach you also about the special needs and stuff. So, I get this is my sweetie love. This one is almost 3 years I'm working with. This one is the one like I told you about the transparency and stuff. This one is the one that is my acting principal. Is the one who's doing the books and stuff like that. Because I'm not going to be there every time. You need assistance. So it's the one who's assisting me. And this one, there is inclusive, ne? EWP. So EWP is paying for this one. She's helping me a lot for paying this one because she did so that I'm struggling a lot. And then I'm like a talkative person. If I'm not going to do something, I just tell you straight, I'm not going to do it. Because they just came to the center and then they said, you must have 5 teachers. I said, I asked you, I can have that 5 teachers, but are you going to assist me on paying that 5 teachers? But they did break this year because I did 5 teachers last year, SAP. I said, you've got the teachers, you give them assistant teachers, but you didn't give this assistant. This year I did get an assistant. And then this is me, the other one. That one is upstairs, ne? Is the one that she's not happy about the inspector firing. She's not happy about the roof and stuff because of the bond, the shutter bond. He said, I must take all that thing down. So I have that thing now to take that thing down. I didn't. When he said, I asked him, how am I going to get the money? He said, you must close down. So I only give you 3 weeks. If you don't do that, you must close down the education center. And then I have to take all these kids. I'm just taking chances now. I did take that. I take chances now to take that kids upstairs. Otherwise, I'm not allowed to take because of that floods. I did make the banner. I did take that photo and banner in front. This one is the great art class. It's the big one. Then, yeah, it's the great art class. And then this other class, they are sleeping there. The one that I'm not allowed to take any. They need children then.
Great, thank you.
And we
great, thank you so much. So my role in this is just to ask a few questions before we open it to the floor. We got a lot of submissions through Twitter and Facebook, so thank you very much for that. To start with, just to give a bit of background, the government is supposed to provide support for registered centres. What does that support look like? I don't know who wants to answer that first.
Well, it's not for all registered centres. It would be for those for non-profit centres on an income. It's the ECD subsidy, and it's, you qualify if you are an NPO that is registered. But also if there's sufficient departmental budget. So there are people who are not getting it simply because there isn't enough funds in the central coffers, lots of people. And so that's one of the big challenges. And at the moment, as far as I know, anyone else, I'm sure you all know, the £1,000 per child per school day for the qualifying children. And the income threshold used to be for combined family income must be less than £3,000. So it's targeted to poor children who are in centres, but there are an awful lot of poor children in centres who won't get it. And an awful lot of poor children out of centres who won't benefit from it.
And Linda, what are the challenges you face in getting that support from government?
The challenge is that I get the facts from government. First of all, it's just like each and every time they came, and then they said, you must provide this, and then you provide this. And then when you did this, and then she's, by the time she came first, but you must do the flow. And then when you finish the flow, she's going to tell you, you must do the same. So each and every time. And then when they came, they discourage you. They just kill your dream. Like when he marched out, you feel like, I feel like I must close this. Because when they speak, they are going to relate you as to the people who've got subsidy. And then they said, on the other day, maybe you're going to have 3 or 4 cars. So do this and do this and do this. They don't recommend, they don't consider that you don't have money. So that's the thing.
And earlier in your presentation, you mentioned the school isn't where you want it to be yet. What does the school look like where you want it to be?
I told myself, when I get this money for registration, by now, I told, you see my friend, it's still okay, I'm sorry, then I told myself, in fact, I need, the jungle dream in front, and then I'm going to have a double store house on top there. But the building told me that because of the space, I even take the municipality land. So I have to stop there. But I told myself that I want the intercom, everything, so that I can see you on the gate when you're outside. And then the resources inside. Because of the lack of resources that is inside. Like, our children can learn a lot, but we are trying our best. So each and everything, I just want to be a model system, I can say. And then it's where I'm going to tell you, Karen, just charge yourself. Because when you get in, I'm not going to charge yourself. No, I'm not going to do that. Because when you see in, you'll see that this is a model city. You're going to tell yourself, I'm not fit, I don't fit on this school if you only depend on primary.
I'm interested in the role that parents have played in both of the presentations. Linda, in your presentation, parents were relatively absent. Why is that? Why aren't parents more of a focus in the sector?
Look, parents are a huge focus, particularly for birth to three. But I think because we were focusing on learning outcomes, which tend to be in classes directed to children, obviously, all the evidence is that what works best is a good program with good parent support. But parents, you sons, if you've got some very involved parents, but parents struggle, particularly poor parents. They've got long working hours, they've got lots to do. They may not see education as something they can contribute to. I don't know if you'd like to comment.
Yeah, it's like that, in that they don't because of coming late at work. But now, since there is this parent involvement training, and then they know their responsibilities. And then we also promote that each and every month or each and every quarter there is that fund. And then if you build a relationship with the parent, and then you call the parent, you speak to the parent if you see that you're struggling with that child. So it's about building the relationship. And then also, sometimes we didn't know that you must use these parents. Now they back off because we don't be involved with them.
Mm-hmm.
Now in our trainings, I learned that I must involve them. Even if I don't have a volunteer at the traditional at school, I ask one of them. Even if I know I don't have somebody to feed the parents, if they come to drop the child, they just stand and just drop the child. They just feed all the children.
Mm-hmm.
And then they see everything is settled, and then they walk up. So like, if you like involved and then transparency, and then you just call them, they become involved.
I'm not sure who to direct this question to, but what struck me with a feature of your presentation was that parents seem to treat early childhood education centers as shops, that they can take their child out of and go to another child, or they can take their child out of to save money. Is that a problem?
Yeah.
And how can it be done differently? Have you ever?
Actually, they don't take it as a shop.
Mm.
They don't know what the early childhood development
mm.
is.
Mm.
They used to those days where they can, the children, they you just take a child and then, oh, mama, this is, you should going to take after my child up until. They don't know that now. It's already changed.
Mm.
So what do you have to do? So actually, what I'm hearing that they've got these parenting skills, whatever, communication, I would love to have in my community because the same challenge that she had, I also had the same challenge. So they still back in their minds, they don't know.
You know, what strikes me too, in terms of the research, is that when parents take kids out to save money for a while, that you're losing the attendance, you talked about this, and that attendance is one of the things that really counts for whether children are going to benefit long term or not. Another thing I've often seen, and I don't know, maybe if peer parents have to go to work, it's not a problem, but in some areas where they don't, children drop in at all times of the day, missing their kind of program.
You have to be strict also on that, because when I did, I closed the gate. At 8 o'clock, I told them this is the same. My program started at 9 o'clock. So by 9 o'clock, and then I do the register for the morning.
Mm-hmm.
So I write in the morning, they were upset. Because if you are not there in the morning, on the morning ring, that means you lose the whole
shot. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So if you stay with them, and then you will lock the gate once, on the second day, and then she's going to get cross on that day. I don't want to lie to you. She's going to get cross on that day. And then when she go back, she said, I'm not going to take my child back there. But if she knows that what the child is missing there, she's going to send the child back, and then tomorrow she's going to be A. And then if you keep on doing that, they will know what they are supposed to do.
Should we have some questions?
I'm just interested now, Linda, what are you charging parents and what are you able to pay your teachers?
Now, what I charge for the children, I've got the forms, and then on that forms, I told that you're supposed to pay from the list that you're supposed to pay for. Supposed to pay from January until December. And then I give each and every parent that came to the school, but they, I told him so that you speak. And then I draft the fees. The one that's using the fees from, I start from zero, but zero, I don't have zero to 3 months. 4, 5, 6 is 250. And then from, I said, those ones that are body trainers. Sometimes it depends because it starts from 1, 2 years, two, three, up to 4 years. I charge 170. When you finish 4 years, and then I charge 150.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like that.
Can you explain to me why it is traditional?
intentional that in all schools there are these age-related fee structures, because the babies require more staff.
Mm.
I understand that, but the older children are eating more, and they're 4 to 5 year olds. They shouldn't be paying the least.
Mm.
Actually, they should be paying the most.
Yeah.
Or a standard fee.
It's a standard fee for that community. Mm. So now we've got that fee, ne?
Mm.
That if I charge two more, ne? They are going to run. They are already do that,
mm.
but they are going to run to that. Now they told us, they promised us that we've got this forum. So if we can like do the meeting in Khayelitsha, they don't charge this peanut that we are charging, because they are united. But in Lower Cross, also in Philippi, they don't charge this peanut. I'm sure it's only us on Lower Cross Road in Philippi. They are charging this peanuts.
Do the parents in your community have more that they could pay if they believe?
They have more.
Okay. So if you provided them with a first class quality school,
that's what
with
I said.
Brilliant equipment, a Model C, can they pay?
That's what they can pay. That's what I said. That I want my school to be a Model C. So that immediately you march in, you will charge yourself. You will see, even if you charge yourself less,
mm-hmm.
you will see that I charge myself less. It's where I'm going to say that you charge yourself less. What about
mm-hmm.
if you can add this? Because you will see that I'm much on the school. It's not because they told us, no, these are the like, Marco goes to the ground, you are going to keep the child.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
all.
Okay.
We have a question from the middle of the room.
What services do you need to promote family
development
with
the data center? And
are
those
services working
for you?
They are working for me. Yeah. So, I've got the parents now, it's on the 10th, né? It's on the 10th, I'm sure. Each and every month we've got this session. Né? This parent is from the mother to child, né? Because she did explain about thousands of days. Né?
Mm-hmm.
And then, when they go on the first day, né? They were not interested, but like, I insist, né? I just beg them. And then I just like, go on my knee when I talk to them. Right? And then they see the need to go to that team meeting. And then like, there is this SAP must give them something, party passes, something that they are going to
come to
that team. So when they go there, a lot of things you didn't know, you didn't expect. Like, you see your child, this is a bully, this is like, they recall those names. And then when they get involved there, they know. Also, when you get the training, we also get this training. You must call the meeting. You must like introduce what you get, what you learn from that training. So also to sit up to the parent, don't deny the parent. Each and every time when you march in the school, you must have communication. Don't just give a child and then just build something, just tell anything, and then just also involve him with the program that we are learning. This, please come to school, my child, tomorrow. We are going to do this tomorrow. And then they know that the children is learning each and every time. It's where again will be built. They know that, no, my child is doing this, my child is doing this. Even at home, the child, when you see the pencil, she wants the book, and then you, I don't know where are my photos, because on the, like, I used to take them photos when they read it. Even those 2 years, they read the book. They are concentrating, so it's very nice. So if you keep the parent involved, that, guys, tomorrow we are going to do this. Tomorrow we are going to do this. Please, just bring the child. They know that the child is waiting for that tomorrow. Because you know what happened? If you want something to happen, just send the child. Don't talk to the parent. Because that child is going to say, please, my teacher said this. Don't speak to the children, to the parent.
Yeah, so there's been a bit mentioned on parent involvement in terms of ECD, but one thing that I've noticed, it seems to be that there's a link or relationship between low-income neighborhoods and parent involvement on schools or in an ECD center. And I wonder if some of the statements that we make about parent involvement aren't also misrecognizing what the problem is. So we want parents to be involved and they're not involved. or we want them to pay fees, but they're not paying the fees. But is that not more linked to stuff which is happening outside of the school in terms of economic situation? I mean, you mentioned the EPWP worker. I think they get paid something like 3,000 to 3,500 for the month. And I know some of them, they're working for 6 months and then you're not working for the next 6 months again. So in those contexts, are we not misreading, for example, that perhaps that parent does want to be involved in school, but they really aren't able to?
That, to answer that, there is a leadership. You see the child, they don't have snack at school. The parents struggle on paying fees. Sort of that. And then maybe she just finished 2 months not paying the fees. There's no snack at all. There's no different like the first or there's nothing, there's no snack, there's no bread, there's nothing. And then it's where, I don't like, I love money, but it's not all about money. I just feel ashamed, even if the parent came and tell me I didn't take my child because I didn't have money. I just told that parent that. It's like when you see me, it's about I'm after money. Which is if you just look me on that on that side, you don't see me, you see me on the other direction. So I just encourage them. But I don't encourage, because if I can encourage them, all of them, they are going to take advantage of them. But there is a leadership. On this leadership, they pay for the children. They don't have, they pay for the parent. They don't have afford the kids. So I've got three children at my school. It's three, it's case three. Azola, who asked them, but they are three. Last year, they were four. So SAEP is helping on paying for that leadership.
So on that point of parent involvement, for me, I was working for an NGO called Sikula Swane in Africa. I was working on a playground. I was working in my community with the children that are coming from this apartment home. They were not paying nothing. We were having cluster workshops monthly for them. They were preparing food for them after the class, the cluster workshop, but they never came. They were not paying even a single cent. But because I left Sikula Songo, those children, we were starting to stimulate them from 10 o'clock until 1 o'clock, which is they still around the location. It's easy for them to get raped, to get stolen, whatever. I started to open my own center. Even today, they're taking advantage of that. They don't pay, but I always, because those children, they believe in me, they know what I'm doing for them. So parents, even if they get paid, if they don't get paid, they not get involved. But if they go to white schools or colored schools, they get involved. They only take the advantage of our culture.
If I can maybe just sort of add something that I've been working on the ground now in Khayelitsha and youth field for a couple of years, and the one thing that I notice in a more formal school situation where there's a proper building and there's a proper structure to it, they suffer the same problems that you do. And in fact, the school that I was involved with in Heathfield, one of the big problems that they have is that when parents register the children, they either leave blank or they put in a fictitious cell phone number. So there is no way that the school can get hold of the parents. The parents do that so that they cannot be chased up in terms of school fees. But of course it does mean that if there's an accident at the school, there is no way of getting hold of the parents. But it's a mindset that I'm not sure what the solution to that is, but there is a mindset that if I don't make contact with the school, I won't have to pay. And I don't know what the solution is, but I've seen that across the board.
I would say that in the black community, there is more of a willingness to pay if they can, but again, many of them can't. You know, we were saying you just have a standard fee structure, and you might say, okay, it's easy if someone has to pay 270 rand for one child, but what if there's one income and six children? Then it becomes an impossibility. So I think that those are dynamics that we do need to bring into the discussion to find solutions for those things.
On that point, that's what I said. I just feel very ashamed when the parent that won't speak to me about the situation. Sometimes you see the situation when you see the child. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you don't see what is happening on the background. So is that parent who need to come straight to you? And then also on the meeting, when you have a meeting with them, if there is only one parent and there's no one who's working at all, you ask the parents that are not working to come and volunteer at the center. So you're not going to charge for that parent. What you can do is just to give maybe something at the end of the month, something that is going to assist that family to sustain.
We have a question. You were speaking about the impact, the relative impact of 1 year versus 2 years.
Yeah.
So what do we do in our country? We have to make decisions about taking the child out after a year to make space open for a new child. Does the 1 year...
Are you talking about in the program that's a year long?
Yeah. Well, yes, theoretically there should be a year long, but often it can go up to 2 years, so you can stretch out. Does the impact of the 1 year warrant... Is it better to replace the child, or to be better for 2 years, and then reach half the number of children?
Difficult questions. I mean, these are real difficult trade-offs. What's very interesting is that I've talked a lot about quality and what really makes a difference long-term, but what we have seen in some studies is the things that are less good quality than the ideal still help to some extent. So, I mean, it's really deciding what is the cutoff? What can you do that makes enough of a difference that it's worth rolling out? And that's a question we haven't really sort of answered properly yet. You know, because there's a level below which you're wasting your money. I mean, as Pam Pickin would say, you might as well burn it. It is a tricky thing. I think in a lot of the programs that you're talking about, also, if there's a parent component, you are hoping to change the parent's capacity to provide stimulation as well. So, I mean, it's not just a child piece, is it?
If you think about a playgroup, which is not just minimal parent involvement.
Yeah, especially.
Yes, it could be
Look, longer for parenting programs is also stronger. So an FCM program that is 2 years, a home visiting program that's 2 years, will have a better impact. In fact, the long-term results from the Turkish early enrichment program and others were very intense for a couple of years. And they lasted, their results showed up to 20 years. But a lot of others don't. So you'll often get a sort of initial gain, but it's what sustains. And for that, you actually need serious state resources.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think we're talking about parents having to pay, but actually the real issue is, why should parents who can't afford to pay have to pay?
Mm-hmm.
Why should the children suffer? And why should teachers not be getting some kind of this sort of support from the state for salaries?
That is actually my question. I know it's probably speculative, and this is the whole room, but it seems to me that we, and I haven't done the math, it's very little bit, but it seems that we spend more money the older children get. So it seems
yes.
that we spend more in the secondary education system than we do in the basic, and it seems that we spend quite a bit for the small number that are in the tertiary system relative to those that are in the basic. So why is it, does anybody understand the reason the government has decided that this is beyond the scope of very, very little money at BCD. It seems a small proportion. I mean, the number that you fill up on final quotes was around 63%. CECD is disputing that, but probably less than 60% of learners in ECD centres, and those that are in ECD centres are there maybe three quarters of the year. We don't know if they're there for the full year. So that's a very, very small amount of money that we're spending on the ECD sector. And it seems that, I mean, does anybody understand that? My question is.
Historically, it was, I mean, I remember in the sort of ancient nationalist government days, there was a quotable quote that parents shouldn't shuffle off onto the state responsibility for their children. And to some extent that, you know, has kind of prevailed, the idea that the family is primarily responsible for very young children. And although all the policies talk about supporting the family to do it, I mean, we just haven't seen, we haven't, it's not institutionalized. So grade R will be funded, and maybe eventually this pre-grade R year will be funded. So it's kind of, we're used to paying something towards schools. And I think that it's just how do you do it and how do you change that. And remember, there is quite a lot of funding going in for health services and other forms of support for young children, which we don't count because we look at this dismal pre-primary spend. But actually, I mean, the big focus of health spending is on under five.
Yeah, can you put right under? Yes.
There are trade-offs in government spend. If you vote for your strong lobby group and you can fight every year, you know, you've got more power than you can't do anything. So you've got, it's a very, you've got a very difficult balance there. And the civil society groups that are fighting on behalf of the youngsters, I mean, that's where the voices have to be heard louder.
I think also one of the challenges is having the Department of Social Development responsible for one age group and then the Department of Basic Education for another.
Mm-hmm.
They've got different funding, they've got different focus, and we're never going to get the early childhood development sector properly funded while we have interdepartment differences in policies and spending and what have you. So I think there has been talk about it becoming one, and the Department of Basic Education taking over all of it, which I think would be a positive move. I don't know if there's going to be more money, but I think rather have one set of rules that you could follow instead of two different agents.
Sorry, there was a question right from the back.
Were you going to comment?
I guess along similar lines to Toby, is that the new integrated policy makes provision for changes to the per child day subsidy and sets out a way in which, I mean, a pathway for restructuring funding to early childhood development, part of which will be to support educators as opposed to children on a means-tested sector. But I don't know how far we are in terms of advancing that. I know that there's work being done with Treasury to be trying to come up with budgets that will shift it, but perhaps some pressure from the sector would help with pushing that further down the line and pushing for policy realisation. All very well to have good progressive policy, but again, it's the classic South African scenario where we've got good policy, but very little delivery. So use it and create leverage from the fact that the policy is there.
Them personally, so a lot of
get them to truly understand the importance.
Can I just say, I think, and one of the real dangers of all of this is that we have sold ECD as going to, you know, it will be the absolute answer to everything. And as soon as we don't have those results, they'll say, oh, it doesn't work. And so that's why the quality imperative is so urgent.
So speaking from a perspective more of working with parents and caregivers of children with disabilities specifically, but I wondered maybe the applicability to just ECD and especially maybe mainstream centres that are not yet including children with disabilities. I mean, there's a whole extra thing that people seem to tackle later. But I just wondered, I know with children with disabilities, parents often become the voice of advocacy, not because necessarily early childhood education is very high on their list, or culturally they have a better understanding of ECD, the importance of ECD, or the first 1,000 days, but more because they have kind of a rights approach. So my child has a right to play with other children, or has a right to be out in the community, hence I take my child to the centre, hence I lobby, hence I join a parent support group, or create a parent support group, and we raise our voices. And I was just wondering whether maybe, you know, parents don't, the fact that a lot of parents in South Africa and a lot of countries don't value early childhood education because the knowledge base isn't there, and they haven't seen that centres, you know, the tendency is that you believe you drop your child off and your child is fed and kept warm and the bum is wiped and the mouth is full, and that's it, that's what happens during the day in a lot of parents' minds. And I just wondered whether maybe if you need to leverage and if you need to get a voice heard, whether parents aren't the key as much as the practitioners in the sector, when we say the sector needs to make a noise, whether it isn't also about getting the parents mobilized, but first obviously it's the awareness that ECD is important, but I know that if we talk about a disability specific viewpoint, often because it has a rights-based approach and it's not just about education, it's so much stronger sometimes. Or it seems, it looks like. I don't know if anyone has an observation on that.
You're absolutely right. And I think one of the things that unfortunately is driving any initiatives for ECD from the fiscal point of view is school readiness as opposed to the right.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's no doubt that children would benefit from a good program even if they aren't going to suddenly become brilliantly school ready. And yeah, it is hard to mobilise, and as you say, I mean the disability sector has been amazingly vocal and organised relative to the gender parent population.
Do you think, can I pop a follow-on sentence onto that, sorry. Do you think that has to do with how we as an education sector present early childhood education in a way? I don't know if that makes sense.
No, more.
Sorry.
No, more.
Just
to
elaborate. Oh, sorry. Okay. So, more usually means keep quiet in my office. I guess what I'm trying to say is, do you think that as ECD practitioners, or as the sector, or as formalized education, we present ECD so much as education and so much less as the right of a child? Does that make sense? That's what I'm asking.
I think a part of that is to do with the fact that a disabled child, you fought for that child. From the day that they were discovered to be disabled in some form, you have fought. And you will never give up for that. Whereas the child that's required no real effort up till this point, you haven't got that killer instinct where I'm going to get my child's rights, because he's been so shortchanged by life. And that fight attitude is what's missing.
Yeah. I've got a comment from Mrs. Holland, and maybe it's a totally different perspective, but I think the spectrum of people involved in the world fighting that fight for disabilities is including, I'm just reminded of that saying that if the middle class is not involved, the struggle is not real.
Mm-hmm.
And in the disability spectrum includes those powerful voices. Whereas the biggest challenge with ECD is the lower quintiles, their voices are just being heard. I don't know. I feel that's a
good point. Sorry, kind words before you, if you don't mind a minute. Okay?
agree with everything that's been said on partly why I think ECD is less visible. I think visible is probably the right word. And you know, shifting attention away from university grades, away from the trick, away from Anna's, towards things like the ELOM, I think is a great starting point. But I guess what's fascinating to me is there's a disjunct between the way that a very successful education movement 2 years ago started on the claim that the Freedom Charter extends the right to education to free university education.
Mm.
And nobody has made that argument for UCD.
Yeah.
And that's fascinating. It's exactly the same argument. And yet, you know, it's there's silence on the one side. So that's what I'm fascinated by, I guess.
I just want to come back to the question of quality ECD, and maybe be a little controversial to say that I think all of us working in the sector are part of the problem too. And I think we're very new to the sector, but I think a lot, I was listening to your story, Linda, and a lot of people have parachuted into your school over the last 16 years, all offering a piece of the puzzle, but not the whole puzzle necessarily, and parachuting out, and thinking that perhaps they helped, and maybe they had a little bit, but they had, in a sense, assumed you knew a lot more than perhaps, because they knew a lot more, they had assumed you knew a lot more. So some of the interventions that they thought they were helping with didn't have the necessary results because they didn't understand your context and they didn't necessarily have the full package. They had what they had and the skills they had to bring. And I think we're wasting quite a lot of money in this sector, in a sense, all because we want to help, but we don't necessarily have the holistic solution. And I think as a sector we need to go back and look at ourselves, because we are part of the, we are some of the flies in the ointment. I always talk about you know, teacher training and development as imagining that I was parachuted in from Mars, and I wanted to learn how to eat like a human. And I would go to a course, and they would say, well, you need to eat nutritious food, and you need to make salads. And I would leave my school, they would think they'd done a fantastic job, and I would leave there not knowing anything about how to eat like a human. And I think so many of our interventions at this level, on every level, whether it's from teaching to administration, to start at such a high level that they are so unpractical that they are not translating into quality education or quality administration. And I think that needs, we need to be self-reflective.
should we have the last two inputs and then we'll wrap up? You've been waiting for your question.
So, thank you both. My question is to you, if you could do anything, what would you do with yourself to fix all this? You spoke about the risk factors, you spoke about what needs to happen with quality. You have a very broad picture, you have years of experience. If you could do anything, whether it's realistic or not, what would you do?
that's a different see, that's such a different thing from, you know, what is possible.
But that's also fine. I'm just
like, what is,
you know,
in a way, I mean, obviously we know that early means earlier. The earlier you start, the better. To really try and focus on sort of parents and their interactions with their children and early nutrition will give you the best result by far. But, practically speaking, probably because of the way the world works, we have more chance of intervening in educational settings and trying to improve the quality there in the ways that are becoming increasingly clear, that are not about some bad qualification. They're about hands-on support. And I think, you know, just to come back to your point, I don't think we're very good at listening to what people need, or what they want, or how they understand them.
Last thing. Thank you. Is it feasible for ECD centres to start collaborating with primary schools that their children go to? Who surely it's in the best interest of a primary school to know what's the quality of that ECD centre? And trying, if I was the head of a primary school, I'm a retired school principal, and I was a high school principal. But if I was the head of a primary school principal,
I would go to the ECD centres in my community, and I would try, and I would put on my application form what ECD centre did you go to, and I would take those children. And isn't that another voice that your ECD facilitators have? And you can even take it a step further and try and form a financial collaboration between the ECD and the primary school, because it's in my best interest that I get that the ECD centre functions.
Okay, can I go to the comment? Thank you for this. As I was working for Secular Solidarity, those parents were not involved for their children. They were like drinking, so we had to go and register this child. We had a partner with the Clumps primary school. Fortunately, when you see the child, she's no longer in that school. She went to other school. Whereas you've got that partnership with that school. For me, as I started my own ECD, I went to Inchinelo Primary School and told the principal that I've got this ECD, I want to make partner with you because it's the closest primary school in my location. But I know that parents won't take their children there. They will sing for other places to take their children. We can make that, but it depends on the parent.
I did do it. Because like I'm not going, they didn't change. Those ones that I did, like I spoke to the children, to the parent, because my child there was in Ethiopia in Israel. So I just asked them, guys, because like by September we get those parents that don't even notice by their children as it's September. And then I just asked I just targeted those ones that I know they are going on radio. And then I asked for their bed and stuff, and then they came. And then I go to Hazelnut School. And then when I go to Hazelnut Primary School, I did register the children. But what happened, what makes me not to do that again? The parent, we set up an appointment that you must bring everything by now. Yeah? They don't do that. They don't give the bed, they don't submit anything. Now you have to go up and down. And then I found out the other one is going to say, my child is going to Isabel, my child is going to Cauliflower, my child is going to... So you must go up and down. But those one who goes to Fab, I just like told them that I can go to Isabel. But the other one, they said, you must go to Cauliflower, you must go to Isabel. So I told myself, no, I can't go up and down to all those people. So I end up not doing it. But those ones, they start from Hazelnut. Even those ones, they ask, when can we start take our children to? I said, you can go to Hazelnut. And then I just take them to Hazelnut.
Great, thanks so much. We hand over time for closing.